Welcome, subscribers. We are talking to Michael Tsarion, and I would like to begin today to spend a little time speaking about Theosophy and its founder, Helena Blavatsky. I myself have not read that much about Theosophy, but I have read enough to understand that there are some very interesting ideas and concepts expressed in Theosophy. And there is also a lot of controversy, of course, and I know that Michael have kind of brushed on these topics in his talks. And when I myself began reading a lot about the New Age and the conspiracies around that, I pretty early bumped up against the work of Blavatsky, and a lot of researchers are, you know, kind of giving her a bad rap, so to speak. But I have a few ideas why that might be, but let me ask you, Michael, why is it, do you think, that she and her work has gotten, I guess, attacked so much?
Because people haven't read her work.
That's a good answer.
Anyway, it's nice to get a chance to talk with you about this because, you know, it is a tangled web. There's no doubt about it that the Theosophical Society is a completely different creature after, you know, Blavatsky died.
Yeah.
It became a different creature after Krishnamurti, you know, went his own way, and he wouldn't buy into the whole, you know, orthodoxy of it.
Yeah.
So it changed again, and people didn't listen to Krishnaji when he tried to disband it. Of course, everyone who was so... It's just like anything that people are into for sort of a social point of view, or they're worshipping some guru, you know,
yeah.
They didn't listen to what the man said. They didn't disband. They said, well, let him go his own way, and we'll just stay with what we've got.
Yeah.
So they stayed with the trappings, and the spiritual leaders had left.
Hmm.
And this is what happens, you know, when sort of you have Hamlet without the hero.
Yeah. The driving...
Kind of a book is Hamlet without Hamlet.
Yeah.
So the leaders go their own way because these are people who are vital, and they're alive, and they're into the true chi of it. They're in with the muse, and then that dries up, and then you have the edifice. You have this, you know, fossil that just persists and persists. And basically, what happened with Theosophy is what happens with a lot of groups. When the second and third, you know, lieutenants took over, they did not have the direct connection to the muse.
Mm.
Because in life, it's a strange quirk of fate that the muse only works through the individual shaman.
Yeah.
This is just the way it is. You know, in the tribe, you have crazy horse. Yeah, there's one crazy horse. You know, there's one Buddha that sit under the tree. There's one Jesus on the cross.
Yeah.
There's one Odin. You know, it's a very singular thing. There's only one Merlin. You know, one Gandalf. It's like, it's a very much a singular thing.
Yeah.
And that person may then, out of the goodness and the virtue that is in them, expand that to create a circle of friends or a order, a sect.
Yeah.
A group, you know, because this is sometimes an extension of a person's own dharma.
Yeah. I mean,
and their own, vision, and that can be, you know, it's not for us to comment on whether that should be done, because whatever guides a person, and especially in the Victorian era, there was a tremendous sense that, you know, the world was changing. They were coming up to the end of the millennium in the 19th century, and people felt a lot of big changes. And remember, people didn't just sit watching TV all day. You had some of the greatest writers, some of the greatest occultists. You know, people like Conan Doyle, the writer of Sherlock Holmes, was a member of the Order of the Golden Dawn.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, you had W.B. Yeats. You had Walter Macken. You know, you had so many ordinary scholars and writers in the secular world, but they were becoming members of these secret societies and fraternities for the good of mankind.
That's very interesting. Yeah, because it feels like, again, this was a point I was going to bring up, because there seems to be a kind of surge, at least in the Western esoteric movements, as you say, in the late, I guess, 18th century and from there onwards. And as you say, many of these, I think, was started out on a really, you know, with good intentions in a lot of cases, but as always, it seems like these movements actually are being hijacked further down the road. Do you
well,
agree on
yes.
that? Yeah.
And it's in two phases. One happens is when the person who's the real brains either passes away or, you know, becomes too much of a hermit. This is what happened with, you know, the Rajneesh group.
Yeah,
with
yeah.
Osho. You know, it happens
Osho.
All across the board, you know.
Yeah.
So if that person topples or they leave the game, then all the little lieutenants and the scurrying ants all then want to sort of compete for, you know, the control.
Yeah.
And it becomes this ridiculous thing. And the thing with theosophy, particularly, is that it then started to become more of a political movement than it did a spiritual movement.
Yeah.
And the reason why I detest people who blame Blavatsky for the machinations of the Theosophical and Fabian Society are people who, for a start, have never read her work, and two, they do not understand that this woman spent her life trying to excise any type of political, social wrangling and maneuvering to contaminate the true spiritual essence of what she was saying. So you don't even have to be into her spirituality. You can like it or not like it.
Yeah.
But this woman was a spiritualist.
Yeah.
This is a woman who climbed out of her own window in Russia instead of getting married at 18 and walked to Tibet. Right? This is a person
yeah.
who left the tiny microscopic, you know, xenophobic, limited life that she was being promised as a young girl
yeah.
and had a greater vision and took herself off and walked all the way from Russia to Tibet to find out the meaning of life.
Amazing.
Right there, when you hear that story, I'm interested. I want to know more about such a person who would want to do that.
Absolutely, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So this is a person who then goes on to create an order. When she finally dies, the place is taken over by Annie Besant and other people who were major political figures in England. And so their interest in taking the spiritual order, they have no spirit. So, of course, that's going to die a death. And then they have to replace it with some other agenda. So the Theosophical Society, which had many dukes and many princes and many of these royalty already involved because they did believe that the Messiah was coming, et cetera, et cetera. They were all looking to be enlightened by somebody else. You know, this is the whole thing.
Yeah.
But Blavatsky had always said that, you know, this is not a political movement, and she absolutely despised politics and knew that the politics was the control of what she called the black sorcerers.
Yeah, yeah.
She always talked about this, but the work that she wrote this in has been suppressed. Everyone has heard of her Isis Unveiled, the two volumes, and everybody has heard of the Secret Doctrine,
yep.
the two volumes. But she wrote a third volume to the Secret Doctrine. It's Secret Doctrine Part 3, Volume 3.
Mm-hmm.
And in that is when she has her most, you know, pressing and most poignant attacks upon politics and upon the secret societies, specifically the Vatican and the Jesuits, but also the Masons and all of these other false Luciferian entities.
Yeah.
She was warning about this, and she was adamant that her society, you know, would not have a political role and start to get involved in world politics, because she saw that all as just nonsense.
Yeah.
She saw that as an expression of people who are caught in their lower ego drives, who are not attending to the work of their soul, and they're preoccupying themselves, you see, with all of this meaningless political machinations.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is a power dynamic. You know, it's all based on power dynamics, and this is not what this person was about. Blavatsky was about enlightenment of the human race, not about, you know, hierarchies of control.
Yeah. So there might be a reason there right away to kind of pretty early on hijack this organization and let it afterwards represent something else, I guess. Do you know if it changed much after, you know, she died?
Yeah, I would say it radically changed. And some people even have speculated that her ill health in the end was maybe even something that was created artificially.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's very easy to read the profile of a teacher, of a master of that nature. They're hermits. They study and read all day. They're not interested in really, you know, pushing the administrative aspect because they want to do the spiritual work.
Yeah.
So they slowly, slowly leave the administration to these other people who maybe have vested interests. And, you know, it's like the old problem with Osho, where, you know, or Howard Hughes, they can be poisoned. They can be poisoned maybe even physically by the people around them.
Yeah.
And slowly put into bad health so that they cannot operate, you know. And, of course, see, the trouble with a virtuous person, one of the greatest problems with a person of the light, is that they project their own light on everybody that comes into their midst. They project their own virtue on the world. And they see everybody as being just as good as they are.
Yeah.
And this leaves them wide open then for, you know, for sabotage.
Yeah, absolutely.
So even if that didn't happen, well, then, you know, she died, and then Annie Besant and Leadbeater and the Webbs and all of these English Fabians that later became the Fabian Society, who were affiliated with theosophy or used theosophy, they used it because it's theosophy already had in it tremendous amount of money. A lot of dukes and princes and nobility were involved. So it was very easy from that point on to say, co-opt the order and turn it to being this pusher of left-wing socialistic, you know, philosophy.
Yeah.
It became like an embryo under which the spiritualist groups hid. But these are individuals who had political aspirations, specifically Alice Bailey. Yeah. Alice Bailey and her husband were major, you know, movers and shakers within the political upper echelons of the Russell Trust and the British secret establishment.
Yeah.
They had direct relationships to the, you know, the British royal family and so on and so forth. And Blavatsky never coveted any of these people. She loathed any of that stuff. Absolutely. You never saw her at Buckingham Palace shaking hands with Queen Victoria or any of this nonsense, you know?
Yeah.
She didn't care about any of that.
Yeah.
You know, it's very much like in Islam. They say that when anybody goes to Mecca, you know, I mean, Malcolm X found this out when he went, that one thing is, when you go to Mecca, everybody, no matter how rich they are, have to change their clothes, and they wear just a simple white robe, so that nobody has any distinction in at the moment when you're going to these great Muslim festivals, you know, in Iran and Persia. There was always a very ritualistic sort of shedding of your class status before you dare approach, you know, the tomb of the Prophet. So this was an Orthodox religion, and it's very much the same in the occult societies. And, of course, you see there's a lot of egomaniacal people who come from great wealth and great aristocracy who don't want to do that. They're thinking, why should I take off my slippers? Why should I not, you know, throw down my crown if I'm coming into the occult world?
Yeah.
I don't want to be faceless. I want to be acknowledged for who I am. I want to walk on a red carpet. You know, and slowly this is what then happens, is that these people want to use these occult orders for their own aggrandizement.
Yeah. Huh. And you know, there is, I don't know if this is fair then to say, but I mean, a lot of other people have done the connection to, you know, I guess we could go in two different areas. First, maybe we can touch upon Edward Bulwer Lytton. You know, he wrote a book called The Coming Race. And do you know if he in any way was involved in Theosophy?
Oh, yeah. He was a very close friend of G.R.S. Meade. G.R.S. Meade was a Blavatsky's secretary who went on to write lots and lots of interesting books.
Mm.
Bulwer Lytton was, you know, again, a highly aristocratic person who was initiated into some very powerful lodges. So these are people who had many affiliations outside of Theosophy. They also belong to Theosophy. So, you know, you might see Theosophy after their name. Oh, this was a member of the Theosophical Society. Mm. And people just leave it there.
Yeah.
What they don't realize is, yeah, this person was a member of Theosophy. He was also a member of the Freemasons. He was a member of the Luminous Lodge. He was a member of the Rosicrucians. I mean, is there a lodge in the world that some of these people were not, you know, involved with? But that doesn't mean that now you say that Theosophy is at fault.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, these are people who wined and dined with the queens and the kings. So what would you expect if people have been tracking any of the work that people like myself do? You know, it's almost like it's a redundant question. What would you expect from these people? These are people who are the aristocrats.
Yeah.
I'm always saying, listen, when I'm talking about masonry, don't be thinking I'm talking about the common or garden lodge on the street. I'm talking about bloodline masons.
Yeah.
Well, Madame Blavatsky was no bloodline mason. She was an ordinary woman, an ordinary girl who studied the great mysteries of life and traveled the world to find out what the secrets of life were.
Yeah.
She's no Bulwer Lytton. These are people who came from the absolute aristocracy, who wanted people like her out of the way. They might have even been very threatened by individuals like that.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, they certainly were threatened by Krishnamurti. I mean, Krishnamurti has many times did talks in front of the United Nations. Do you know that? He used to. Hmm. He actually was called many times to even address the groups with all the presidents.
Hmm, really?
In America were there to listen to his mystical, you know, teachings. And you know something? He used to get up and basically scream in their faces what a bunch of evil bastards they were. Oh, yeah, he's well known for really hammering all these presidents and these dignitaries at these different seminars that were put on.
Mm.